So first we'll have a look at this semi-enclosed rewireable fuse, BS3036. Often taken out now in domestic dwellings, distribution boards have been changed, upgraded from plastic to metal, and the overcurrent protection devices are often also upgraded to circuit breakers, and they can still be widely found in commercial and industrial installations. These rewireable fuses, BS3036 semi-enclosed fuses, all come of a very similar design. So I'll pull out a 5-amp rewireable fuse, okay, denoted by colour white as well. We're going to get to that in part of the presentation as well. It looks very similar in construction to the 30 amp rewireable fuse, except when you turn them over, you can see the brass pins on the 5 amps are considerably smaller than those of the 30 amp design. This causes some issues because people tend to, when rewiring these fuses, go for the first fuse element they find. So if the line circuit is disconnected or the socket circuit is disconnected, whichever fuse wire is found in the cupboard tends to be the one that's reinserted into the actual rewirable fuse itself. So as we turn it over, you can see a fuse element is attached between the two brass pins, in this case rated at 5 amps. But if the customer was desperate to get the lights back on, are they paying that much attention when they get the fuse wire element out of the cupboard? And this one rated at 15 looks very similar. If they were to place it between the two brass pins by inserting it through and attaching it to the two screws, the lighting circuit's likely to come back on as long as the fault's been cleared. Therefore, the customer's happy. Problem being now, we've got potentially a lighting circuit fuse not at 5 amps and a considerably higher. In this case, this would be 15. Therefore, we're running the risk of shock, fire and explosions in the installation. And you look at the pins, you can see that one is designed to carry considerably more current than the other. So the actual construction is not designed to carry any more than the rated value of it, in this case being 5 amps. Some other considerations for a rewirable fuse is the fact that the fuse element is open to the air, therefore liable to deteriorate. Also, because it's not enclosed completely, when it's carrying too much current or an overcurrent or a short circuit current, obviously the fuse element itself is going to get very hot. The heat's going to cause the element to break, obviously through melting. Because some of the heat can escape, that means it's not the most precise device that you could get. They have fusing factors, all the devices we're going to look at. And the fusing factor for rewirable fuses, in this case a 5-amp one, all the rewirable fuses have a fusing factor of 2. That means it will take twice the current, in this case 10 amps, in order to cause operation of the device. Because of this poor fusing factor, when we later in our course notes looking at designing circuits, it's been extended, which is protected by a rewirable fuse, we must take into consideration a correction factor for using this type of device of 0.725. We'll come up with that in a later set of notes in the classroom. One of the early take-home tasks I'll be setting my learners is to look at their distribution board, look at their earthing arrangement as well, take some photographs. Earthing arrangements are covered in two of my other presentations, looking at TNS and TNCS earthing arrangements. I would also expect my students to be looking at their distribution board or distribution boards of friends. I'd like to think that we could find a distribution board that had an older style overcurrent protection devices, whether they be rewirable fuses or cartridge fuses, using the colour scheme. So we've got a white carrier white dotted fuse for 5 amps. We've got blue for 15. We've got yellow to represent 20. And finally, we've got red to represent 30. And they're the sort of things that we need to start looking at and noting in the real world. We're also going to need to know the prospective short circuit breaking capacity. In other words, the amount of current under fault conditions that the device can handle and clear and not cause, for instance, the fuse wire element to melt, remelt across, actually not disconnecting the circuit, but re-solidify and obviously become a fuse element that's still connected between the pins. The rewirable fuse can withstand anywhere between 1 and 4,000 amps under fault conditions. One of my previous presentations looks at PFC measuring an installation. However, you need to know the S1A, S2A and S4A of the actual fuse wire element itself. 1 being for 1,000 amps, 2 being for 2,000 amps and 4 being for 4,000 amps that it can clear under short circuit faults. However, even on the fuse wire element itself, I cannot find S1A, etc. So you always have to presume the lowest rated. So in other words, 1,000 amps. These can only clear faults up to 1,000 amps. And when you're testing for PFC, you need to confirm that the prospective short circuit current won't exceed 1,000 amps, as these devices will fail in that part of the installation. But many of the negatives to go with rewirable fuses, there must be some advantages. They used to be very cheap. Now they're not because nobody uses them. So they're more expensive to buy than circuit breakers. So that's an old cliche exam question when the advantage of using a rewirable fuse is that it's inexpensive. That's not the case anymore. I would suggest probably the only advantage is it doesn't have any moving parts. Therefore, not having a moving part doesn't need to be functional tested. Also, not having a moving parts, that they can't fail. So the mechanism within it cannot fail because there is not one. So I suggest their only advantage is there's no moving parts. Therefore, they cannot fail.